Hey, thank you so much for joining us here today. If God is using this ministry to impact your life, we'd love to hear your story. Send us an email to amen@linkchurch.com. And if God is using this ministry in your life, why don't you partner with us financially? You can do so at linkchurch.com and select the best financial option that works for you. Help us to bring this message to the rest of the world. Again, thanks for listening and enjoy today's message.
The best we've ever seen, and we're believing that. And if you're here for the first time, I saw many hands going up. A warm welcome to our campus. My name is Mark, and get the privilege of being a part of this church and being here week in and week out, but meeting some incredible people. How many of you know it's we're not a perfect people, but we serve a perfect Savior. And it's a joy to be with you this morning. Just want to highlight one thing from that church news, the breakfast show. It's 8 o'clock on a Friday. If you are on Facebook, go and tune in live. Dubsy hosts that. It's amazing. It keeps you updated with what's going on in the life of this church, but more importantly, what's happening on in our community. You get a surf report. You get to hear how the Sharks are doing. You get more than that. And so why don't you check it out? Friday mornings, 8 o'clock. And also a big thing for us is interest groups. And we really believe that God just hasn't saved us. He's called us. And so he calls us to grow. And we transformed. And interest groups are going to week 5, 6 to come. And then we got heart and soul, family, fun, and future. You never been part of heart and soul? You better come and join us. Church isn't to be endured. It's to be enjoyed. Awesome. One guy with a smile at the back there. Lovely. How are you doing at the back there? Good? Awesome. So we're ready to go. God is building a home. And just last week, we got to touch on it and how that he hasn't come to fix you up. He's come to fit you in. God hasn't called us to be wanderers. He's called us to be worshipers. I love how Dill spoke about how he gives us permission to belong to his story, but then he also positions ourselves brick by brick, stone by stone. He's building a home. Someone once said this, a house is made of bricks and beams, but homes are made of hopes and dreams. There's one thing to have a house, but a house plus love equals a home. And God's desire for all of us, no matter where you have, wherever you've come from, wherever you might live, God's desire for you is to live under his purpose, for his purpose. When we know and we live for his glory, it'll define your story. And so we have the privilege to be a part of something so much bigger than ourselves, the local church, the hope of the world. And today, last week, he spoke from Ephesians 2. And we wanted to carry on in this series because we really believe that God wants to speak to us about what it is to build a home, how it is to be part of a house. And I know one thing is a home represents a family. I love the example used last week with a fridge that's always full. We have the opportunity to reach up and say, Lord, feed us again today. Feed us from heaven's supply. Feed our hearts full. I pray today and I ask you to do this. I'm giving you permission. Open your hearts. Let God speak into you because he wants to speak to you. Will you receive it today? So open your hearts. Last week, we looked at a New Testament scripture. In the New Testament, we see Christ revealed. Today, we're going to look in the Old Testament. We see Christ concealed. But if we look carefully and we look, we can see the types and we can see the shadows of Jesus. I pray today your heart will be captivated by one thing and one thing only, Jesus. Jesus would enter your heart. He would speak into the depths of who you are. He would remind you that you loved, that you might be walking through some despair. He wants to give you hope. You might be walking through some pain. He wants to remind you of his prophetic promise. God wants to open our ears so that he will remind us of a God that loves us and knows us intimately. That's the beauty of being part of the church. And today my message is home away from home. Touch your neighbor and say, I'm coming home. I'm coming home. I'm coming home. Home away from home. And the tagline is this: living an exemplary life in an exile land. Living an exemplary life in an exile land. Living a blessed life in a broken land. Living a significant life in a stressed out land. Living a faithful life in a fearful land. How many of you know that the Bible says that we are strangers in a strange world, that we aren't yet home. We are traveling through the landscape. We are traveling with God. When someone tells you, no, God is about a destination, no, 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 he's not. God is about a journey. He wants to journey with his people. We won't reach the destination until one day, in the twinkling of an eye, we go to be in heaven and see our Savior forever and ever. But until that day, we're going to journey with God. And anytime we journey with him, he wants us to grow and become more like his son, become like his character, Christ in us, the hope of glory. How do we live an exemplary life in an exile land? And today I want to look at a man who was born many, many, many many years ago, 587 BC. His name was Jeremiah. They call him the weeping prophet. It's because he wept over, he had such a compassion for people. He wept over Jerusalem. If you see Jeremiah, he's a lot like Jesus. In fact, in the New Testament, the people asked Jesus. Jesus asked them, who do you say I am? And some said, are you Elijah? Are you John the Baptist? And someone said, perhaps he's Jeremiah the prophet. The only prophet to ever be likened to Jesus was Jeremiah. Jeremiah wept over the Jewish people. Jesus wept over the state of Israel. Jeremiah preached under the guise of the Babylonian Empire. Jesus preached under the guise of the Roman Empire. Jeremiah was cast out into Egypt where he was persecuted and died for his faith. So too Jesus was persecuted by those who knew him, the Pharisees, the people of the day. And then he was persecuted and killed on Golgotha for our sins. Jeremiah and Jesus. Whenever you see Jeremiah, you see Jesus. But Jeremiah lived in a place that, with a people, the people of the nation of Israel, that had begun to believe in the created things and not their creator. They had started to mistrust God. They had started to believe that actually what is created is far more important than who is their creator is. They started to believe, like someone said, in their shekels rather than their savior. They started to believe in their homes rather than the home giver. They started to trust themselves instead of trusting God. And so God, in his kindness, like any good father as a parent is to his children, will realize that he loves them too much to leave them on their own. He loves them. His desire was always a living relationship with his people. And when he saw them going astray, like any good dad to a son, he'll say, son, come here, my boy. You need to learn some good lessons. And today he wants to teach us some good lessons of what it is to live an exemplary life in an exile land. And we're going to go to a scripture, Jeremiah chapter 29. And you might think, oh, 11. Have you heard that scripture before? 29:11. And you see, when you see it, you see the words go up, and behind it is this beautiful sunrise and this beautiful sunset. Behind it is a beach landscape. It's like God has plans for you, plans to prosper and hope you. But I want to tell you, friends, the context to which this letter is written is totally different. They were in exile. They were in some turmoil. They were going through some pain. And it's in that space that God wants to remind you today that he has a plan and purpose for your life. Perhaps you feel in pain today. Perhaps you're going through a tough situation in your business. Perhaps finances isn't this, and perhaps you're living in a place you don't want to live. God wants to speak to you today. Would you listen and hear him? Let's read it together. It's in the Message version. It says this, 29, starting at 1. It says, this is the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to what was left of the elders among the exiles. He has a letter that's being written. He's written a letter to the exiles. What had happened was King Nebuchadnezzar had come along. We'll read it now. He came along and he sent all the leaders. He took 10,000 people and he sent them 700 kilometers away into exile. And, you know, you might be sitting here, what does exile mean? Exile means to be in a place you don't really want to be. Now, I don't know, we are naturally born exiles. We came out of our mom's womb. We were born into a world that we didn't know. We were exiled. You remember the first day you went to school? You could still smell the leather from your barter tuffies. Remember that? And your stiff uniform. And you walked into class like, I can't believe I'm in Miss Gallagher's class. She doesn't even sound the same as my pre-naught teacher, my 00 teacher. Now, and what about the time you went to high school and you arrived with your trunk and now you're in a different environment? We were born into exile. We experienced change the whole time. Those of you over 40, remember the time we got dressed in your army uniform and you put your thing on your beret and it smelt, didn't smell good then either. And then you wore those shoes that went halfway up your shins. And then you landed at some forsaken place called Potchefstroom where you had some little corporal that chased you around the day all day. You're going, oh my gosh, I'm in exile. The reality is we're all in some state of exile. With the changing emotions, changing climate, changing government, changing leadership, changing whatever. We're all in exile. But how is it that we are called to live an exemplary life in an exile land? The Hebrews had been moved into exile land. And there they were. And Jeremiah, it's this context that Jeremiah writes a letter. It's this context that Jeremiah wants to write a letter into your heart today. You might be living in Mhlali, Belito, Zinkwazi, Salt Rock. I don't know where you're living. But in many ways, you might be that. He wants to talk to you today. He said this. He said, left the priests and the prophets, all the exiles from Nebuchadnezzar has taken to Babylon from Jerusalem, including king. Even the king went, the queen went, the government leaders, and all the skilled laborers and craftsmen. Anytime you want to make people scatter, take the leaders out. The devil's devise is to take leadership out. When you take leadership out, it can change a nation. You take leadership out, it changes a government. You change leadership out, it changes a school. King Nebuchadnezzar realized that when you take the shepherd, the sheep scatter. And then he said, Jeremiah says, no, I'm not going to have any of this. I'm going to write a letter. And he says, the letter was carried by Elasa, son of Shaphan, and Gemara, son of Hikkai, whom Zedekiah, the king of Judah, had sent to Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. Oh my gosh, all those words in one word. He says, and the letter said this. Here's the letter. In the Old Testament, we get a practical letter that's given to us. In the New Testament, we get a letter written on our hearts. And he said this, this is the message from God of the angel armies, Israel's God. I love the fact that Jeremiah knew who his God was, the God of the angel armies. And he begins to write. And then he says this, he gave instructions, build houses and make yourselves at home. Houses and home, houses and home, houses and home. Put in gardens and eat what grows in that country. Marry and have children. I love this one. Marry and have children. It's always the former before the latter. That's some good news for some parents. You always get married first and then you have children. That's just wise. And encourage your children to marry and have children so that you'll thrive in that country and not waste away. How many people believe today that God hasn't called you just to survive? He's called you to thrive. He's called you to thrive. I don't know, that's like a 10-second praise break right there. And he says, make yourselves at home there and work for the country's welfare. Pray for Babylon's well-being. If things go well for Babylon, things will go well for you. Pray for Mthali, because if you pray for Mthali and things go well for Mthali, they're going to go well for you. Pray for Durban, because if things go well for Durban, they're going to go well with you. Pray for this province, because if things go well with this province, they'll go well with you. Pray for this nation, South Africa, because if you pray for South Africa, things will go well with you. Jeremiah. You know Jeremiah, when they came to him, they said, Jeremiah, Jeremiah, don't say too much. He said, God has put a fire in my bones, and I cannot but stop playing. You know what I like to call Jeremiah? The man who was on fire. Fire. Because he realized that God had put something so powerful in him that it welled up a confidence to speak the truth and the truth only. You know what I love about Jeremiah? He would always tell you what you need to hear, not what you want to hear. Maybe today you need to hear something from God about what it is to live an exemplary life in an exile land. Maybe today you're going through a family situation or you're dealing with a financial issue, whatever. What does it look like to stand up with character? Because the world looking for men that would stand confident in the God they know. He's the God of the angel armies. He's the God, my God, the God of Israel. He says, pray for Babylon. And then, I love this part too. It's like the guys who bought the letter, they almost, now I can imagine it. You got like 10,000. There are 10,000 Hebrews. They must have hired out some big warehouse. I don't know what it looked like. But they're standing with the letter. They've just finished reading it, and it's almost like drop the mic kind of moment. They just drop the letter, and they say this. He says, believe it or not, this is the message from the God of angels. We have a choice to make. Believe it or not, this is Israel's God. And then he said this, don't let all those so-called preachers and know-it-alls who are all over the place and they take you in with their lies. Don't pay any attention to the fantasies that keep coming up with up to please you. They're a bunch of liars, preaching lies and claiming I sent them. I never sent them. Believe me, it's God's decree. You got to be careful of people that always trying to give you false hope, always trying to tell you that it's a quick fix to knowing God. Hey, you know what? You come to know God, now straight ticket to heaven or whatever. No, no. Be careful of those things that like to tickle our ears. Because God, when he talks, he's not about reaching a destination. It's about journeying with him. God is patient and is dealing with you. He will take you from glory to glory, but we go in his step, not your own. Be careful of those who promise too much and underdeliver. Because God never promises. He always delivers on what he promises. He always says, God might not say what you expect him to say, but he always do what he says he will do. We think some things about God, but no, listen to what he says. When we listen to what he says, we get in line with him and we move forward. Jeremiah, the man on fire. And he said this, he said, this is God's word on the subject. As soon as Babylon's 70 years are up, you know what the false prophets were saying? Oh, don't worry, guys, it's going to be 7 days, we'll be back. No, hold on, sorry, I changed it. 7 days have passed now, and I'll be 7 months. Oh, sorry, it won't be 7 months, it'll be 7 years. And they kept on moving the goalpost. No, Jeremiah stood up, he says, hey, it's going to be 70 years. This is what I see in the Bible. Moses said, a man who lives to 70, lives to 70 to 80 years has lived a long, blessed life. If you've lived that long, thank you. Any 70 or 80 year old here today? 70 or 80 year olds today, hands up quickly. Awesome, thank you, Jesus, for our 70 and 80 year olds. You can be great. Thank you, Jesus. But you know what? I want to tell you, that's a lifespan. And I want to tell you, God wants us to take us through a journey with Him, not just reach a destination. We're not going to hit 7 years and go, boom. No. It's a desire to walk with Him. Link Church is 9 years old, my friends. We're still just in the beginning. But we're not going to just go, this is at 12, 15, and book out. No. We're going to walk a long road with Him. We're not going to stand around and wait for Him. We're not going to be dictated to by an economy and what the naysayer says and what the papers say. No, we're going to listen to the prophetic promise over our lives. We're not going to wait for information. We're going to receive some revelation. That's the church of God. You know what? There's a voice that comes from heaven that reminds me who we are. We're not some like, no. We're going to stand our ground. God has called the church. Church is the hope of the world. We stand our ground and we move forward slowly, patiently listening to His voice and not everybody else's voice. Jeremiah would say, stop listening to the false prophets. Those people say, oh, you've got to do this and buy that and do this and put yourself in debt. Stop listening to the false prophets. Listen to your Father in heaven. He still wants to speak. He still speaks. It's one of our interest groups. Yo, he's loud and clear. He still wants to speak. Come on Tuesdays. I got lost. I've got three big ideas that I want to share with you. If you're taking notes, you can write them down. This is going to help you live an exemplary life in a world that seems like it's upside down, in an exile land. And Jeremiah realized that the people, you know the Hebrews, they're complaining. They're like, hey, they're sitting there like, oh, we're just going to make some shacks. And are we in Babylon? It's terrible. The people talk a bit, it's like maybe you've come down from Joburg, you know, in Belita. You know, in Joburg, it's flat, it's everything's brown now, it's cold, you know, it's cold, and you're used to that, and the oaks talk differently, like, But you come down the north coast, and here it's like, how's it, my brew? And you got like landscape of sugarcane, people walk, no one answers their phone after Friday, and it's north coast. And I'm saying, it's different to Joburg. You've been, at Joburg, you've been running like this, you come to the north coast, it's like, oh, it feels like you're in exile. Hey, it feels like, and you want to go back there, but no, God's called you here. He's called you to here. And so what are you going to do here? You're going to live an exemplary life in an exile land. You're going to choose to change the way you see things. And you're going to go, He's called me here. It's 2017. He's put you in this church for a moment right now. You know where else? There's no superhero coming through the door there. There's no plan A, B, C, or D. You are His first choice. Right here, right now, as a church. And so we're going to say, no, I'm going to brace where I am right now. Someone said this, you've got to bloom in the doom. Bloom in the gloom. You're going to be those people that bloom from the inside out. Could rhyme with boom as well, but we won't go there. So anyway, so first number one is to decide. To decide. You see, they dropped the mark. They dropped the letter on the floor. As they dropped it, he said this, believe it or not. You know what he's saying? Your faith doesn't grow by chance. It grows by choice. We need to decide, are we going to believe God or not? Are you going to believe Him or not? It reminds me of a story. His name's Colonel Sanders. He added 11 spices to his chicken. KFC. It might be in heaven later. I don't know. But anyway, so Colonel Sanders, 1956. He's 56 years old, and he starts this little business in Corbin, Kentucky. And he starts this business, and tragedy struck because they moved the road. So he went out of business. And he thought, no, I'm going to stop there because I believe in my chicken and 11 spices. And he started to sell it to restaurants. And then the restaurants were like, oh my gosh, we love this chicken. And he said, well, I'm going to go on my own. And he started his own. And we know the story. Years later, it's all over the world. I mean, there are more Kentucky Fried Chickens in our surroundings here than all the world. Africa loves fried chicken. Anyway, so here's the thing, and I want to read it. You know why? Because we have a decision to make in our lives, and Jesus spoke about it. We can either choose the easy road or the hard road. The easy road or the hard road. To this day, if you go to Corbin, Kentucky, there's a plaque up in the museum, and this is what is written down. I want to read this to you because today, so many of us, the Babylonians, Jeremiah said, you're taking the easy road. It's time for you to shift your perspective and make a decision and take the hard road. Because the hard road might seem hard in the beginning, but in the end, it leads to life. Jesus spoke. Let me read this for you. This is on his plaque. It says this, it is comparatively easy to prosper by trickery. The violation of confidence, oppression of the weak, sharp practices, cutting corners, all those methods we are so prone to palliate and condone as business shrewdness. It is difficult to prosper by keeping of promises, the deliverance of value and goods and services, and denouncing the so-called shrewdness with sound merit and good ethics. The easy way is efficacious and speedy. The hard way is arduous and long. But as the clock ticks away, the easy way becomes harder and the hard way becomes easier. As the calendar records the years, it becomes increasingly evident that the easy way rests upon a hazardous foundation of shifting sands, whereas the hard way builds a solid foundation of confidence and cannot be swept away. Thus we built. Thus we built. I want to tell you, Jesus mentioned that. He said there are two roads. There's the wide road, the easy road that leads to destruction, but then there's the narrow road. It's the hard road, but it leads to life and life evermore. Which will you choose today? Will you choose the easy road or the hard road? God says, no, choose the hard road, because in the beginning, it might seem hard. You know why? Because it's around integrity, discipline, loving, excellence. But when you start here and you start out there, it leads to an easier life, a life filled with purpose and a good end. It's a prosperous end. What will you choose today? The easy road or the hard road? Hey, Hebrews, hanging around in Babylon, in Babylonian there, sitting out and checking out. Hey, it's not the easy road, it's the hard road. Choose, decide today. The second is this, commit. Commit. God wants us to commit. Jeremiah, when he gives instructions, he gives four instructions on how to commit. But when he gives it, the language he uses is one with build, make, put in, eat. I tell you what, when you eat something, you commit. Am I right? You don't just stare at the food. You commit to eating KFC. When you look, you're like, you commit. You commit. The language he uses is commit. Marry, you know what they say when you say your vows? You know what you're doing? You're making a commitment. He says marry and make. You also, anyway. So marry and make, it's a commitment language. The word make, it's commitment language. To commit is to endeavor to live an exemplary life. Here's an important thing. God, when he speaks about commitment, when Jeremiah speaks about commitment, he doesn't speak about interest. You know, today's age, I don't know what generation it is. It could be ZYZ. I don't know. These all the new generations come through. But all of us, we're 95 to 5, if you're 8 years old, whatever you're today, God speaks to us. You know what? Today, we're interested in a lot of things. I'm interested in doing a bit of gym. I'm interested in going to the beach. I'm interested in trying that. I'm interested in that business. I'm interested in the Sharks sometimes. I'm interested in South Africa. Whatever. We're interested. The danger with interest is that you only do it when it's convenient for you. But commitment, it doesn't matter what happens, you are about the final result. It doesn't matter what happens, you put your life into it. Commitment is saying, you know what, I'm going to put everything into it. God is looking not for casual people, but committed people. Committed people are saying, you know what he says to them? Build your house and make a home. That is commitment. He says, well, we're not about a casual faith, we're about a committed faith. It's a bit like the conversation between the chickens and the pigs. You know, the chicken, they're talking about breakfast, so the chickens are clucking their feathers like, look at my contribution, I brought some eggs to the breakfast. And the pigs turn around and said, yes, we see your contribution, but when we give bacon, we make a true commitment. There's a difference. There's a difference between contribution and commitment. Hey, friends, when you get married, it's not about what you can contribute. It's the commitment you make. It's when you arrive at work, it's not about your little contribution. It's the commitment to arrive early, arrive with excellence, and do everything you can for that person in front of you. It's about commitment. It's not about contribution. God is not, yes, contribution, but God ultimately is looking for men and women that are going to commit to Him and who He is. You want to know what an exemplary life looks like? It's a man who decides and then he commits. Kelly Slater, one of the world's greatest surfers, he said there's a good surfer, he surfs when there's right conditions. A great surfer gets in when the waves are high and it's overcast and raining. Come sun or shine, they are in the water. You know why? Because they are committed. Committed. There's a difference between a casual faith and a committed faith. I love this scripture. It's on the phone here. It says Psalm 37, verse 5. It says, if you commit your life to God, He will give you light in the darkness. This Message version says it so well. It says, open up before God. keep nothing back. He'll do whatever needs to be done. He'll validate your life in the clear light of day and stamp you with approval at high noon. I wrote this down. A committed life of faith leads to a light-filled life. He will approve you, confirm you, endorse you. When you live in a committed life, there's more and more and more and more of God. There's a light for a greater future. There's a light to touch people's lives. There's a light to transform you from the inside out. Who wants to be committed today? It's no longer about a casual faith. It's a committed faith. Just as we had mentioned earlier, there are about 100 people last week that signed up to say, you know what? We're going to choose to believe. I might not have what I need, but I do have a seed. You know what that tells me? They committed. We are committed to building a church. We are committed to reaching nations. We are committed to seeing people come alive in Christ. You know what that means? I'm going to show up here on Sunday. I'm going to invest in my family. I'm going to look around the room and see where I can help people. I'm going to believe and give myself to the Lord and then to the church. When we do that, something begins to build in us. And you know what God says then? Your best is yet to come. I will shine a light in your life like you've never seen before. I will cause miracles to happen like you've never seen before. I will stand with you in the pain because you've believed in me and come my way. 65 verses of the New Testament speak about commit. Commit your way to the Lord. Commit your way to Jesus. You know why? Because look how he committed his way to us. He went like his face like flint towards Jerusalem. He says, I'm going to go and die for you and I. And our response is to say, I'm going to embrace the God life and do whatever I can. Hey, Hebrews, you want a key to unlocking life in Babylonian? Start to commit yourself to God. Four ways he does it. The first one, he says, build houses and make them home. Houses and home. Build. The language is not beautify. You're going to stroke the house. No. It's to build. Build costs you something. Build is going to take a sacrifice. Build is like, I'm going to build not for a short term, long term. And there's something, there's this difference between, you know, building and making a home. The words I see there is like, hey, Hebrews, stop camping and start constructing. You see, I don't know, some ladies will agree, mums will agree with you. You know, when you go camping, you only go camping for 2 or 3 days, nothing more, amen? You know, you don't want to hang two around the camping yard. Your camping is temporary, but construction is forever. You know, camping is you can go for a 5-man tent, maybe get 5 people in maximum. But a house, when you construct a house, you can build a house for families to come, for generations to come. That's the picture of the church. We're not here to just camp out. We're here to construct, dig foundations, be a part of this community, give everything we can so we can see your glory. Build houses and make homes. Build houses and make homes. The second one is this, put in gardens and eat what grows. Put in gardens and eat what grows. I love the fact that a garden has to do with cultivation and life. Whenever you see a garden, you see life. I want to tell you, there are people that we have the opportunity, in spite of what we're going through, to bring life into our circumstance. You can put a garden by the words you speak. You can put a garden by encouraging somebody. You can put a garden by believing the best over a bad situation. You can put a garden into your business tomorrow. You can put a garden into your school. You know why? Because you rock up with a different heart, a committed heart to say, God, I'm going to be here for a while. Whenever somebody puts in a garden, someone said that when you put in a garden, you believe in tomorrow. You believe in this nation. You believe in this province. You believe that God has you here for a reason. Put in a garden. Over 150 years ago, we got to do a sisterhood event the other day at a place called Groutville. Groutville is named after Eldon Grout. In 1820, he came out here as a missionary, and he planted a church. And people said, you'll never reach these people. He got to learn their language. He got to translate the Bible into the Zulu language. And there's a church that's still standing today in Groutville, the UCC Church. We got to meet Reverend Mkhize. You know what Eldon Grout did? He planted a garden. He believed in tomorrow. He believed in this nation. How much more should we right now? How much more we should be those people that plant gardens in our families, plant gardens in our businesses, plant gardens in this church, and believe that God, by your power, you will bring life and longevity to this country. Plant a garden and eat what grows. The third one he did as part of commitment is to marry and make. Marry and make. You remember that song from Tina Turner? What's love got to do with it? Got to do. You remember that? You remember? Okay, only me. Oh, what's love? You know what love has to do with it? Everything. Love has everything to do with it. When God used marry, I thought, why would he say marry? Marry to the Hebrews. Why marry? You know, why would he do that? Because your marriage is the greatest illustration for sacrificial love. Your marriage will make something happen in people's lives. Your marriage, and you will make babies. You will have children, and children are families, and families get to invest into this community. Families get to go where we haven't gone before. I look around the room, and I see the Hardys, and I see the Smiths, and I see the Chettys, and I see the Hodgsons, and I see the Yarnes, and I see the Marais, and I see the Naidus, and I see everyone together. You know why? Because families come together. There's a generational blessing over families. You know what? Someone said this, you'll be known by your opinions, but you'll be remembered for your love. Link Church will be known for its culture, known for its worship, but it shall be remembered for its love. Love resides in a home, resides in a family. Embrace your families. Bring them to the Lord. Pray for their salvation. Let's be those church that speak life into our families. Let's see our church, our family, transform this world through the love of Christ. You'll be known for your opinions, but you'll be remembered for your love. Don't stand aloof from the people. Hey, Hebrews, don't think you got all worked out. Come down to their level. Learn the culture. Learn what they do. Walk on the streets and smell the KFC. Start to make shekels in Babylonia. Start to do business. Start to walk around and make some deals, because that's what you do, Hebrews. Ooh, there's a gift over your lives. And they're like, okay, we're going to do that. We're going to plant gardens. We're going to make business. We're going to hustle till they come. And Jesus said, what am I doing? He said, I'm about my Father's business. Hey, Hebrews, get about your Father's business. Stop waiting for the second time to come. Stop waiting for the better job. Stop waiting for the better family or the better husband or wife. Don't look at them now. But stop waiting for all that now. You have who you have because God's put you there right now. Love them with all you have. Be committed to them. Stand next to them. Stop waiting for your son to try and be something he's not. Just embrace him for who he is. Look into his eyes and love him and say, you are worth it, my boy. I love you so much as a dad. You have everything in this life. If we would do that, I believe God begins to transform us. And I love the last one. He says, pray for the city of Jerusalem. Pray for Babylonian. Because if it goes well with Babylonian, it'll go well with you. Pray for its shalom. You know what shalom means? Wholeness. Transforming life. Oh, friends, our prayers can shape this nation. It can shape this community. Quad Nakusa community can be shaped by churches that begin to believe for the shalom of our nation, the shalom of our cities. Let's pray, because when we pray, we can change it from the inside out. When we pray. The last idea, as I want to end off today, you can decide. Today, God wants to, for some of you, it just needs to be a decision that needs to be made. Father, I'm going to choose to believe you. And maybe for some of you today, you've been a bit casual. You've been coming, you know, you've been like, I'm casual in my marriage, casual in my workplace. But God wants to remind you to commit. Because when you commit, he'll bring life to your light. Light to your life. The third thing is this, succeed. Succeed. We see in the story that, you know, in this story, you know what happened that day when he dropped the mic? I think 10,000 of those Hebrews fell to their knees. And they said, no, we're going to choose to believe you. We're going to repent. We're going to choose to believe you. You know what we're going to go and do? We're going to go and build some houses. We're going to go and love on people. We're going to have children. We're going to invest in this business. And you know what happened? They were there for 70 years. It is the greatest 70 years in the nation of Israel ever recorded. They changed it from the inside out. It began to flourish. Creativity, innovation. The Babylonians stood back and went, oh my gosh, who are these Hebrews? They literally changed. It became the Babylonian Empire. You know why? Because of 10,000 people that choose to live in an exemplary life in an exile land. They took the promises of God and they stood on it and they began to walk forward. They had success. But you know what the greatest success was? It wasn't so much that they made big money. It wasn't so much that they changed. You know what the greatest success was? They found God. In the exile, they found the thing they were longing for the most. They found their Father. They began to open the scriptures, and they didn't just get information, they got revelation. When they began to pray, they prayed with such a deepness they'd never prayed before. They got to experience the outpouring of the Holy Spirit that they never encountered in their lives. You know what they got to get the most? The living God in their presence. You see, they thought they were being kicked out on the outside, but they came to realize that that outside, that exile, was actually the center place of where they would meet God. I want to tell you, friends, when we give our lives to Him and we decide to follow Him with all our heart, mind, and strength, we can encounter the living presence of God. And it got to the letter hadn't finished yet. And I want to read the last part, because this is the one we all remember. This is Jeremiah 29, verse 11. And this is the promise over our lives. And he said this, I know what I'm doing. Doesn't that bring us relief? God knows what he's doing. He knows everything. It's in his plans. He says, I have it all planned out. Plans to take care of you, not to abandon you. Plans to give you the future you hope for. When you call on me, when you come and pray to me, I'll listen. When you come looking for me, you'll find me. God's desire for us is to look for him. Yes, when you get serious about finding me and you want it more than anything else, I'll make sure you won't be disappointed. I'll turn things around for you. I'll bring you back from all the countries in which I drove you. I will bring you home. I'll bring you home. If you want it this morning more than anything else, his promise is that he'll bring you home. His promise is that you will find him like you've never found him before. And when you find him, you will never, ever be the same again. Just this Friday, we took a moment to have a memorial service for a good friend of ours and a family. They're part of the family. He's a grandfather. He's a father. He's a friend. He's a business partner. We got to say goodbye. We got to mourn, but we got to honor his life. And one of the friends got up to share. And he got up and he spoke about his life. A man he had lots of experience within friendship. And he said, I know this guy. I know him so well. I love the way. And he always used to say it. Chris would always say it. He'd say, stop dilly-dallying. Stop dilly-dallying and make a decision. Stop dilly-dallying and making a decision. And I heard this and I thought to myself, as we shared this morning, Jeremiah, that's what he was saying. Hey, guys, stop dilly-dallying. Make a decision. Embrace the God life. Let him inspire you from the inside out. Stop dilly-dallying. If you've looked past over the years and you look back and you think like, what happened in 2014? What happened in 2015? Then maybe you've been dilly-dallying. God wants you to say, hey, stop dilly-dallying. We're on a trajectory to growing in God. We're on a trajectory to seeing his presence and power in our lives. We can expect him to come through in our halves. Stop dilly-dallying, friends. Let's decide to follow him with all our hearts, our minds, and our strength. And he says, I will not disappoint you. Come on, why don't you stand?